Man, I just love our old MacBook Pro. This thing has been a workhorse. I love how thin it is. It's the 16-inch model, so this thing has just been a joy to work with. It's been our mobile recording beast, and it has been a real trooper. But it's getting a little old in the tooth, and it's starting to chug on certain applications. So is it time to switch? Let's find out. Hey guys, it's Steve from Featherlight Studio, and by now I'm sure all of you have heard that Mac has released the new M4 and M4 Pro and Max series of chips, and they are impressive. Now, up until now, we've been using our trusty Intel-based MacBook Pro. This is an i7 with a ton of memory, and it has been a beast of a machine. It's been our backup for our in-studio system. It's been our pro recording system for all of our mobile work, and it has done a fantastic job. But it's starting to chug for some of the more intense applications, and we're really considering upgrading and taking the loss on the new machine, because we spent a bunch of money on it when it first came out, and finally upgrading to the M4 and M4 Pro possibly. And we really want to make some comparisons here to see if it's really worth that, or should we just keep this machine and continue using it since it's doing a fantastic job still. The fact that everything from the M4 to the M4 Pro and Max chips are available means you can build exactly the system that you need. Build a killer mobile system or build a complete replacement to your desktop. Apple has done a ton of optimization for these new chip systems, and not just for their own apps, but for things like gaming. And apps like DaVinci Resolve run even smoother. And if you need a configuration that is absolutely the most powerful in the smallest possible package, it is possible to build a configuration that competes and in many ways beats the original Mac Studio M1 and M2 chips. But doing that gets expensive quick. Our MacBook Pro is a surprisingly expensive investment for us in 2019. Our particular configuration came with 32 gigs of memory and a 512 SSD for storage, had a touch bar, which I absolutely loved, and the best speakers of any laptop I've ever used. But it had the Apple price tag to match. It's been a great machine, but now has a trade-in value of about $500. And if we wait much longer, that used or trade-in value is going to plummet to near zero.
All right, with those kinds of performance gains, it's pretty obviously a no-brainer we're going to be upgrading to one of these systems. But the question is, which one? There are a mind-numbing array of CPU, GPU, storage, and memory configurations available to us. Now, if money's no object and you just want to build the most powerful system you can possibly stuff into the chassis of a MacBook Pro, great, you got a lot of options and configurations available to you. But like a lot of other people out there, us included, money is absolutely an object.
Our trusty Intel-based i7 MacBook Pro had a single-core performance of about 1290 and a multi-core performance of about 5,223. Compare this with the monstrous performances of the 16-inch M4 Pro MacBook Pro that has a single-core performance of 3687 and a multi-core performance of 21658. So things have gotten a lot more powerful since 2019 when our machine was released, and we need to find a chipset combination that's going to work within our budget, but more importantly, within our system's workflow. So the M4 base model MacBook Pro is a powerful setup. Up to 10 cores of CPU and 10 cores of GPU. You can put up to 32 gigs of memory in there, and you can support up to 2 6K displays. But with that increased performance and clock speeds, there's a couple of things that a lot of people aren't talking about. Just like with the release of the new Mac Mini M4 base model, there's been a lot of release issues related to fan speed and heat. Both the 16-inch models of the M4 Pro and the M4 Max, as well as the 14-inch M4 Pro, have dual fan designs as part of their cooling architecture. However, the base model M4 and the 14-inch chassis for the MacBook only has one fan to cool all of that increased clock speed and performance. This is a pretty significant consideration if you plan on using these in a studio environment or if you plan on doing mobile recording or other audio-related tasks, which we do a considerable amount of. Add to that the difference in Thunderbolt speeds between the base and Pro models in addition to the GPU and CPU combinations, and it gets a lot harder to justify the M4 base model MacBook Pro for serious Pro audio work. The new M4 Pro chip in the MacBook Pro has some significantly upgraded specs, up to 14-core CPU and 20-core GPU combinations. You can put up to 48 gigabytes of unified memory in there, and it supports up to 3 6K displays. In addition, the M4 Pro chipset
has the much faster Thunderbolt 5 protocol, in addition to adding an extra ProRes and video encoder engine, dramatically speeding up your workflow. This is a huge consideration if you plan on using your machine for both pro audio work and intensive video applications, as both the M4 Pro 14-inch chassis and the two 16-inch chassis have dual fan architecture to help cool all that additional performance down. Just like the M3 Pro chip that preceded it, the M4 Pro chip really seems to be the sweet spot when it comes to performance versus your hard-earned cash. And lastly is the absolute beast, the M4 Max. This is available in both 14-inch and 16-inch chassis sizes. It gives you up to 16-core CPUs, 40-core GPUs. You can get up to 128 GB of unified memory, and it supports up to 4 6K displays. And thankfully, both the 14-inch chassis and 16-inch chassis versions of the Max have the dual fan architecture to help cool down all this insane power and performance. However, all that cutting-edge technology comes with a cutting-edge price tag. Here's where some would say Apple's predatory tiered pricing structure really begins to add up. So, for example, if we take our M4 Max chipset configuration and we start doing a build-out, say we start choosing the nanotexture display, that's $150, and an extra $1,000 for 128 GB of unified memory, and we choose, let's say, 8 TB of storage, we're way past the Mac Studio configuration price tag at way over $7,000. Now, realistically, 8 TB of storage is probably unrealistic. Let's choose 2 TB of storage instead. That still puts us above $5,000. With the M4 Max, Mac Studio right around the corner, which has better cooling by design and better CPU and GPU options, this maxed out MacBook Pro configuration becomes a lot harder to justify the cost, especially when you consider the heating considerations in a much more compact laptop style chassis. So really this boils down to workflow. What exactly do you need your laptop to do? If you need the most powerful system you can possibly get in the chassis of a laptop, then you're definitely looking at, you know, Max chip configurations. We already have a Mac Studio, which does the bulk of the heavy lifting for video editing here in the studio and a lot of our pro audio work. So our laptop is going to be a secondary machine, but it does need to run cool and quiet, and it needs to run in a variety of different applications and scenarios and be really, really silent. I can't have the fans blowing like a jet engine back there when I'm doing really, really critical and quiet pro audio work. So we really need to balance this out and choose a build that's going to be powerful enough to be able to get the bulk of those kinds of editing and audio tasks done, but also be really portable and still work within our budget. So to make this choice a bit more manageable, we're going to divide this up into 3 different budgetary categories. And your mileage may vary, but we don't need the additional weight and size of the 16-inch, so each one of these categories will include the 14-inch model. The first category is going to be a base model M4 with a 14-inch chassis at around $1,500. The second build is going to be as close to under $2,000 as we can keep it, and again, using that same 14-inch chassis. And finally, for comparison, although outside of our current budget range, a build that's under $3,000. The idea behind this first build is to keep it as affordable as possible. We're going to choose the base model M4 chip, and we're going to choose the $1,599 configuration. And this gives you the standard display. It gives you 16 GB of unified memory. And if we chose a 1 TB storage, it would bump the price up to almost $2,000. So we're going to keep it at its $512. This makes for a very small, light, and very powerful package that accomplishes most of the tasks we need and keeps us well within our current budget. And next we have our under $2,000 build, which keeps us firmly in the middle of our current budget. So we're going to choose the 14-inch version like we did before, only this time bumping up to the M4 Pro chip and using the 12-core CPU and the 16-core GPU configuration. If we choose the larger, the 14-core CPU and the 20-core GPU configuration, it adds another $200 and starts to put us outside our working budget category. So for now, we're going to stick with the standard configuration, and it comes with 24 GB of unified memory as standard, and that's an improvement over last year's Pro chip model. If we bump it up to 48, it adds another $400, which puts us pretty far outside of our budget. And because we're bumping up to the Pro model chip here, that gives us the newer and faster Thunderbolt 5, so we can add additional SSD storage pretty inexpensively. And our final category is the under $3,000 build. And admittedly, this puts us outside of our current budget, But for comparisons, we're going to be building the system around the M4 Pro and not the Max chip, since this really is kind of the sweet spot and the most value for your money. So if we pick the configuration that starts with a 14-core CPU and a 20-core GPU, and we choose the standard display, we're at about $2,399 here. And this base configuration comes with 24 gig of unified memory. The super high-speed 1 terabyte internal drive is important here, as it allows apps and programs to swap to it when system resources start to run low. But we're going to make one change here. We're going to actually change it to 48 gig of unified memory. It's an extra $400. But this is going to make a giant difference in music production, especially when it comes to large sample libraries and things that have to stay in memory simultaneously.
All right, so after all of that, what did we end up going with? Well, for all of the things we needed to do our particular workflow, the thing that ticked the most amount of boxes was the M4 Pro chip.
And specifically the 14-inch version, this chassis is just so incredibly portable. And when you look at it side by side with our older Intel i7 MacBook Pro with the touch bar, you really get to see here by this comparison just how incredibly portable this powerful little beast of a computer is.
This thing is just incredibly small. It's super light. I love the portability of this size. It's a lot smaller and more portable than our old 16-inch system was. And if need be, this thing can back up the entire studio in a pinch. So for that, it's been great, and it can actually do some surprisingly involved video editing. But as that video editing gets more and more intense, the fans do spin up and create a bit of noise, so we have to kind of factor that into whatever scenario we're actually using it for. But for the bulk of the stuff we're going to be doing, especially pro audio work and mobile work, this thing is a perfect fit. So hopefully you've arrived at a chip combination that works for you. For us, this ended up being the M4 Pro. Hey, thanks for hanging out with me today, you guys. I appreciate it, and I appreciate the company. If this was helpful in any way, shape, or form, please hit the subscription and notification bells. It really does help keep the channel going, and it helps me make more videos like this. Stay safe. Be creative. Add something creative to the world. I could really use it. Take care. We'll catch you guys in the next video.